This next experiment is gonna blow your mind. Now for this experiment, I'm gonna be using a neodymium magnet. Now it has to be this type of magnet because this is extremely strong. If you use the little black magnets that you find on your refrigerator, it won't be strong enough. Definitely get one of these. You can get them at a hardware store. You might find smaller ones and you can stack them together. But for me, I'm gonna be using a 1-inch neodymium magnet. And I took a beaker and I filled it up with just water here. And it's just sitting on foam right now to float on the water. And I'm gonna put this magnet really close to it, but I'm not gonna touch it. And I'm gonna see if I can push this beaker across the water. It's going, see if I can build the momentum. That's so cool. So we know water is repelling from the magnet because it's diamagnetic. Well, fruit has water in it. Since water is diamagnetic, that means fruit that have a lot of water in them will repel from a magnet. We're gonna see these forces using this. This is what's known as a torsion pendulum. It sounds really fancy, but really what I'm doing is suspending this little stick using really thin thread. I tried fishing line, but it seemed to be a little too rigid, so it would twist up. This allows us to see very, very weak forces. I'm just gonna put a grape on each end of this torsion pendulum. You can use a straw, you can use a stick, but the real secret is to get them to balance. Ta-da! Now, with this setup, we should be able to see the grape repel from the magnet. So let's give it a shot. There it goes. How weird is that? Your fruit is magnetic, diamagnetic. First, let's take the straw out. Now you're gonna want a dry straw or a clean straw for this, and you place it on top just like this, all right? Now using only my telepathetic powers, I'm gonna see if I can move this straw, ready?
I'll get it to spin all the way around. And in the other direction.
Now I know what you're thinking. He's secretly moving the table without telling us. No, I'm just kidding. It's all about the science. Let me explain. Now we've learned about static electricity on other episodes of Impossible Science, but this time you are the secret. By secretly rubbing a plastic straw against paper before we do this effect, I generate static electricity. Negatively charged electrons jump from the paper to the plastic, making our straw have an excess of negatively charged electrons. When your skin gets near negatively charged electrons, the electrons on the straw repel the negatively charged electrons on your skin. This causes the electrons on your skin to move out of the way. As the electrons disperse, they leave behind a small area on your skin where there are more protons than electrons, making just that section a small local area with a positive charge. With your skin slightly positively charged and your straw slightly negatively charged, the straw is now attracted to you. Opposites attract. Did you see me charge up the straw with paper? Take a closer look.
Okay, there's three major ingredients to doing this experiment. The first one is the surface we'll be doing it on. I tend to use salt shakers because of the bevel on the top of the salt shaker. They're curved. So that straw is actually teetering on there and there's very little friction for it to spin around. But that means you can also do it with like a bottle cap, anything where the straw is not just resting all the way across, because that would be really hard for it to spin on. The next thing to do is the placements of your hands. You don't want them on the same side of the straw. The straw won't know which way to spin because they're gonna be both pulling towards your hand. And lastly, the charging of the straw. Well, that's easy to do. You can either use the paper as you drag it off to charge the straw, or just take a paper napkin and tell everybody you just need to clean off the straw and get all the oils off of it. You're really taking electrons from the napkin and putting them on the straw. Now the cool thing about this straw is now negatively charged, and when it gets close to your fingers, it's actually just displacing the electrons in your hand. So what happens, the electrons are pulling away, so that's relatively a positive charge right there. So when I place my thumb near it, it's slightly attracted to my thumb. If I put my fingers on the opposite side, it's attracted to my fingers. Same as if I do the opposite side. Now, important to realize, I can't do the same side because they cancel each other out. This guy's pulling and this guy's pulling. So you want to hold them like this, where the fingers are closer on one side and the thumbs on the other. And then once it gets going, you can just keep the momentum going. and you can go back and forth. And it really comes down to making sure that your hands are on opposite sides. See that? So you can either try to do it by sleight of hand and make it look like your hands are on opposite sides, where these fingers are closer to the straw than these, than your thumb. Or you can do it by like this. It gets a little bit easier as it spins around. But the real secret is the placement of your hands to throw everybody else off. That's how you're gonna give everybody the illusion of telekinesis, by always remembering you can use static electricity and nobody would see it. Let me show you how to set up this experiment. You're gonna need 5 toothpicks. They don't have to be the color toothpicks. You can actually use any ones. The thicker the toothpick, the better. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna bend them. We're gonna try not to break them in half, but they're gonna bend like that. And we're gonna do it for all 5. Now, we're gonna put them in this arrangement with the bend parts towards the center. And if they don't line up, that's okay. Just bend them even more. And that's it. That's the shape right there. All the bends into the center with 5 different toothpicks. And all you have to do is just add water. By adding a little bit of droplets to the water in the center, what's happening is the wood, through that capillary action, starts absorbing the water. This absorption of water causes the wood to expand as it swells up. That swelling up straightens out those fibers and causes these toothpicks to move. Now, you could just do this on a table and make it look like you have superpowers. Isn't that great? Just moves on its own. Perpetual motion machines are a mythical machine that actually generates power. It'd be like having an engine that's producing power, but it's not running on coal or oil or even fuel. Now, the idea of a perpetual motion machine is nothing new. There's records of a machine like this going back as early as the 1100s, with Bhaskara, a Hindu mathematician who decided he was going to build a machine that works continuously by just using weights and wheels. If we could create something like this, it would be free energy for all. You could change the world. So why is a perpetual motion machine impossible? Well, it violates what we know about science so far. See, energy can't be created or destroyed. It can only be transformed from one form to another. So the idea of filling up this container so that gravity makes the water go down the hose enough to fill itself back up, this would be impossible. But I do know an experiment that looks just like this, and it's not a trick. So what makes the perpetual motion fountain that I built in my backyard impossible? Well, I shrunk it down so you can see what's actually going on. Take a look at this clear hose. If I fill up this reservoir a little bit, the water goes to the lowest point. No surprise, right? It sits right here. But take a look at this. The water doesn't just sit down here and fill up one side with the reservoir. It fills up both sides equally. They're coming up to the same height. And if I fill up more water, same thing happens. When this settles, they'll be equal heights. So there's no way to actually put enough water in this reservoir to be able to push the water back to go higher than the top of this reservoir to fill itself back up. Because as I add more and more water, well, you guessed it, it's just gonna overflow at the lowest point. So there's no way to get this water to pump back into it, which is why what you saw in my backyard, well, that's an illusion. But there is a water fountain I'm gonna show you how to make that looks like it works on its own. It has no pumps and it looks like magic. It's not a trick. It's called Heron's Fountain. Now, I know it's just a couple bottles and some tubes I put together, and I'm gonna show you how to make this. But this is really cool, because with a little bit of water, I can get the fountain to start. Now, there's no pumps, no hidden compartments, just science. There it goes. Now, with just a little bit of water, the water pushes down into this chamber. And then this forces air into this chamber, which then pushes water down, which through a tube goes back up to the top, which then forces water back to the bottom, which then forces air to the top, which then forces water to the top of that chamber. Pretty crazy, right? So even just a little bit of water gets the whole thing started. Now, this experiment is easy to make, but very hard to master. So I would strongly recommend starting off with a smaller orb and building up to it. So I'm gonna start off with one about 4 or 5 inches about here, okay? Now you can, using this, you can actually tie another knot because it's easier to hold onto because it's got that little knot in it. Or you can do the same thing with the tape, tape the ends and cut that off. I'm actually gonna do the tape, the end, so I don't have all this excess I have to figure out how to navigate. So I'm gonna take this, I'll put this about here, cut off these ends. Now I'm gonna tape these 3 ends together. Now you want them roughly the same length, because when the orb inflates because of static electricity, then we're gonna want them to actually inflate evenly. Sometimes if you don't have enough of a static charge, it doesn't inflate evenly, but that's okay. All right, so I'm gonna take this, tie this into a knot here. Okay. Great. So now I've got a knot there, and I've got a knot there, and I'm gonna cut the excess off here. And that's it. That's all you need. Now, I usually make a few more of these just when I do the experiment. That way, if I lose one, I don't have to stop everything I'm doing. And if you have friends, grab a couple more PVC pipes because it's a lot of fun to go back and forth to see how long you can keep it up in the air.
All right, you can hear the crackling sound of the static charge building up.
Now, if you don't have a strong enough charge, it'll actually attract to the PVC pipe. So, and you might see that happen if you're not building up a strong enough charge. The solution? Well, charge it more. Oh, and by the way, if you live in a place where it's really rainy or humid, it's a little bit harder to build up a static charge on a PVC pipe. So just letting you know, if it's raining outside, this might be very difficult to do.
Let's try again.